In accordance with the open meeting law, the board states for the record that this meeting is being recorded by NORCAM and may be recorded by other local media. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome our guests this evening and those watching on cable. First item on our agenda is public hearing on the FY 2017 tax classification. Liz, are you ready? Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Mr. Chairman, can I read the notice?
Oh, I'm sorry. That's right, it was right here. No, I'm going to read the notice first, sorry. Okay, the Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on Monday, November 21st, 2016 at 8 p.m. at North Reading Town Hall, 235 North Street, Room 14, to determine the percentage of the local tax levy to be borne by each class of real and personal property for fiscal year 2017 in accordance with the provisions of Mass General Law, Chapter 40, Section 56. Interested taxpayers are encouraged to be present to present oral testimony at this hearing or may submit information on their views in writing to the Board of Selectmen's office either to the above address or via email at townadministrator@northreadingma.gov no later than 12 noon on November 17, 2016. Signed by myself, the chairman of the board. And I'm going to ask Michael first, did you receive any
comments? No, we did not receive any comments.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, if I might, for the record, indicate that because of the way the statutes are written, there may be a potential conflict of interest because I have a family member who owns both commercial property and residential property. While it would not influence my decision one way or the other, I will be recusing myself from the board's discussions and vote on the matter, and I will be situating myself in the audience.
Okay. Thank you, Steve.
Good evening, everyone. How is everyone tonight?
It's can you?
Very cold. I don't know who ordered this, but they can take it back. So tonight we're here for the property tax classification hearing, which is a mandated hearing for the Board of Selectmen to cast core votes. We're going to go through the slides. A lot of them are repetitive from prior years and just updating and to remind you of what the different terms are that we need to use for the voting process. So the first agenda is the roles and responsibilities. Understanding the levy classification for the classification considerations. The selectman's role, which falls under Mass General Law Section 56. The selectman shall annually first determine the percentage of the local tax levy to be borne by each class of real property. We will see some slides going forward that will show you the delineation of the residential, the commercial, industrial, and personal property. The assessor's role. The assessor's role of each city and town shall determine the fair cash valuation of such real property for the purpose of taxation. Classification of real property shall not be implemented in any city or town until the Commissioner of Revenue has certified in writing the assessors that assessments on the real property that they propose to make are at full and fair cash valuation. That's what we call certification. Once the Department of Revenue has my valuations in there, they then, after the methodologies have been determined, contact us and give us certification on our values.
And my understanding of that, that has been done.
That has been done. And there's a slide in there a little further down, because this year was a revaluation year. So that entails much more valuation process. So I've broken that down a little bit more, just so you, you know, you guys can see an interim adjustment year and a revaluation year are vastly different in how the values are certified. The key terms of the levy limit, this is just in there as just information that we all are aware of. How the levy is calculated. It's the total assessed value divided by 1,000 times the tax rate actually equals the total property tax revenue, or the levy. Understanding the levy limit. Proposition 2.5 restricts growth in the levy, not the rate. The budget process involved in the levy limit plus 2.5% plus any new growth is the result of the budgets in Massachusetts that are revenue driven. Determination of the assessed valuation is a process separate from setting the levy. North Reading's profile, Bob, this is the one I was going to say where it breaks it down for us. Out of our total levy, 5%, I'm sorry, that 9, it should be 5, is made up of the residential values. Commercial, industrial, and personal property make up 12.18%.
Excuse me. That would be 12.5%, right?
12.5.
So that is correct.
That's for FY17.
That is 87.
She was referring back to FY16.
Okay. Sorry about that. So as you can see, the levies in this slide show you from 15, 16, and 17, and that's our annual growth of the levies. What is a split tax rate? Communities decide to tax residential, commercial, industrial, and personal property differently. Statute allows an increase in the CIP, or commercial, industrial, and personal property share of the tax levy up to 50% higher than the residential. It does not generate new revenue. It only allocates the levy burden. There's 2 years in which the town of North Reading actually did split a tax rate. And that was 1988 and 1985. Chapter 200, the Acts of 1988. All this is explaining when classification actually became a statute. And I'm not going to read all that. It's just explaining when it became statute. Commercial property valuation. The appraisal process involves the assembly, analysis, and classification of various types of information into a value estimate. The three approaches traditionally used to value property are the cost, the market, and the income. Does anyone have any questions on that part? The assessor considers the amount of data collected, the strengths, the weaknesses, and the relevancy of each valuation approach, and determines an assessed value for each property. In Massachusetts, property must be assessed at full and fair cash valuation. The term full and fair cash value, or market value, 100% of value, and fair market value are essentially synonymous. The town of North Reading currently issues our tax bills to the commercial and industrial properties on cost, not the income and expense, with the exception of one property, and that's on the Wilmington side. And that's because that property borders our property. The two towns, we split that building, so you have to come up with fair market value of what that property is as a whole, and then the two towns discuss the percentage that each town actually owns, and that's how it's determined. And that's, it's not uncommon. The methodology is very common, actually. The Department of Revenue certification process is very straightforward in the methodology used. The town must prove the three approaches to value, the cost, the income, and the market, with sufficient data to support the final values. The income and expense statistics. North Reading mailed out 287 income and expense reports. 176 were returned. The penalty for the 111 that were not returned amount to $27,750 in revenue, which is $250 per parcel that is not returned. That is the maximum that the Department of Revenue allows us to put on those properties for income and expense unreturned. The income and expense are the 38D. Those are the two identities for the same term. Is used to develop the market rents, the expenses, and a vacancy rate, which then will be applied to all the commercial and industrial properties. And that means if X property did not return their income and expense, the analysis that we have enough of a sampling that we know the retail properties on Main Street yield between $16 and $22 a square foot. So even though property X did not return it, we're still going to apply that market rent to it. Do I have any questions on that?
Michael.
So last year, so this year it's about 61% return, right?
Right. We're pretty plateaued. There's a graph, actually, I think, after this slide.
I'll wait.
Yeah, it's last year we had 109 that we charged, and this year was 111. So
there's a reason they don't return it, though. That's the point, and everyone knows it. It's circumventing the system to their advantage, and it's wrong.
Right.
It's wrong. And the residential, the people on the 88% side, they bear the consequences of it.
Right. The best and the most that I can do as the assessor within the law is to apply the market rent that has been established from like kind properties. You see what I'm saying? So if the retail store at, on Main Street doesn't send it in, but I have a good sampling of other retail stores of like kind, like size, and the location, then I apply that same market rent. So even though they're not returning them, I don't know, and I would, that's the best that I can do is apply that same rent. The income and expense reports are not tied to any individual property tax evaluation. They are analyzed to determine the average market rental rate, which is what I just explained as far as applying it to all properties of like kind. The first process in determining your rent schedule data is by collecting the INEs. The INE data is then analyzed by the different commercial and industrial class codes. A better term for that would be for use. You have retail, you have fast food restaurants, you have office space, automobile. All those are delineated by use and then analyzed from that, and then location. The reason for this is due to location, building, and use in that next week, that next part about the $20 per square foot is what I just explained. If the community does not have enough data in the returns of the INEs, the assessor will then check local markets in the abutting communities. There are program resources such as LoopNet, CoStar, and MLS that we also use to ensure that we're at market rent expenses. The resources are a great tool to verify your INE data return is within the market range. When the rent schedules are finalized, they are then applied to all properties of like kind. The properties that did not return their INE paperwork is subject to the 250 penalty. And this same methodology is actually done throughout 351 communities in the state. On the next, Mike, here's the graph. We're really pretty much plateau. We didn't implement this until 2012 for the penalty. So we did gain in 2012 and 2013 on the return. And then it's pretty much plateaued for the next 3 years.
Thank you.
The North Reading residential property classes. We have 4,258 single family homes. We have 755 residential condos. We have 72 multifamilies, which make up 5,085 total residential parcels. This slide is leading into the residential exemption, which is one of the votes. We'll talk about the open space, which is your first vote. We have determined that the town does not have any classified open space. Open space is tracts of land that are not already identified as like farmland, Chapter 61, Chapter 61A or 61B. All of our large tracts of land already have a use code of these other Chapter 61s identified to them. So the open space discount doesn't apply to the town of North Reading. the residential exemption. This is actually, what I've done with the residential exemption is I've really taken the slides from 2 weeks ago. So the data that we saw 2 weeks ago is the same data that we're going to look at tonight. Nothing's changed on that. The residential exemption, the Board of Selectmen may adopt an exemption up to 20% to shift the residential class tax burden from lower assessed properties that are the principal of a, the principal residence of a taxpayer to higher assessed properties and to properties that are not the principal residence of a taxpayer. We do not really have any secondary homes here. So the second part of that, we don't have enough of those. I could probably count a handful. On this slide, this would be if the board was to take a 10% exemption. And this is the same slide that we looked at 2 weeks ago as far as the number of parcels that would be, it could be affected, and what the tax shift would do and the cost savings to the lower valued homes versus the higher values valued homes that would see the increase. Slide two for 15% exemption, same scenario, same methodology. The savings on the lower end and the increase on the higher end. And our average value for this exemption, our average value home, I did say it 2 weeks ago, but I didn't say it tonight, is $502,121 or $100 is what we would round that to. And I should say not. So scenario three is a 20% exemption. The next vote is a small commercial exemption. The small commercial exemption works the exact same way as the residential exemption, only its values are based on commercial property of $1 million or less. And they have to have less than 10 employees. The Department of Unemployment sends every assessor's office a list for businesses that they know that could qualify in this. And one of the things you want to remember is, like, if you're in a neighborhood shopping center or small strip mall, if an exemption is given, it actually is given to the property owner, not the business owner. It's not given to the businesses. It actually, the savings goes off to the property owner. I do review the list from the unemployment office, and there's 56 potential businesses or properties that could qualify. And that number pretty much stays the same year after year. I looked back a couple of years just to see if we had any change or swing in it, and we really didn't. And then last but not least is the classification. The Board of Selectmen may shift the town's tax burden from the residential class to the commercial, industrial, and personal property classes, as long as the shift does not exceed the minimum residential factor. North Reading's minimum residential factor is 87.9. We'll use that round number. This means that no more than 12.15% of the residential class burden can be shifted to the commercial, industrial, and personal property classes. The following page contains information on the impact of any shift of the tax burden. And again, we're not changing the levy. We're only taking the same levy, and we're moving the tax around. This is a pie chart just to give you a look at how the levy is dispersed. And we are definitely a bedroom community with the 87.9% residential and then the 12% making up the commercial, industrial, and personal property. On this scenario, this is the impact of any shift that the Board of Selectmen may choose to do. The tax rate that you see in the 100% of 1613 is not a certified rate. That is an estimated rate. Until it goes into Boston and that's certified. So I just wanted to make sure that everybody's aware that 1613 is not certified. So if you look across, you can see on a 10%, 25%, and 50% impact for the commercial and industrial and how it changes the rate. For 10%, you'd be looking at $17.74 per commercial. The residential would go from 1613 down to 1591. If you move over to the 1.25%, the tax rate for the residential would decrease to 1557. The commercial, industrial, and personal property would move up to $20.16. If you take the maximum shift of 1.5, the residential would decrease from 1613 to 1501. Commercial, industrial, and personal property would increase to $24.20. Are there any questions on that?
This is in Dropbox.
Yeah.
Oh, it is Dropbox? Not in the meeting packet, though.
Oh, okay.
It's in the meeting folder, though. Selectmen.
I don't know.
It's in the folder for tonight's meeting. It was added just prior to the start of the meeting.
That's why I'm looking. I always move them.
Yeah. I didn't get it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we heard.
It's okay. That's the only slide that was hard to see. If you go and refresh it, will come up. It does come up now. Thank you.
In conclusion, the Board of Selectmen before you tonight have four votes. The votes for the open space, this is not on a slide. The open space exemption, the residential exemption, the commercial exemption and tax classification. To set the tax rate, we must set the tax rate and mail the tax bills before December 31st. That all takes place after we have a certified tax rate. I would like to take a moment and just go over the questions from the residential exemption from 2 weeks ago. When Mike had brought up the Reading bill that's in legislation right now, I did speak with the assessor over there, and I did pull up the bill. And how this bill is going to work, and again, we need to remind ourselves that it is in legislation. When that will be done, they're putting it under a home run rule, so they're really hoping that it's done as soon as they meet again in January. How this is going to work is the taxpayers are going to have to file their taxes and apply for the circuit breaker. So the circuit breaker gives the residential taxpayer, that's it, age requirement. They have to be 65 years of age to file for the circuit breaker. So that for 2015, don't quote me, but I think it was $1,075 for the circuit breaker reduction in their taxes. So how this exemption is going to work is they have to file that, and then whatever percentage that the board chooses to exempt will be the means test, as they call that, only came from the circuit breaker number. So that percentage is going to work off of the other one. So there's still the application process. You can't get out of that. The application process still has to be done. You still have to follow all of the same rules. So even though that community is looking at FY18 for implementing this, providing legislation passes it, which they really don't have any anticipation of it not passing, that's what I'm being told now. They're looking at FY18, but they're actually currently getting their application process working now and getting, because that all has to go in for approval. So there is quite a process that goes with that. Can't say it can't be done, but it's a very simple method. But it's going back to the taxpayers that have to file their income taxes and then file the circuit breaker. And it'll work off of that.
Matt? Ask a question?
Yeah.
Looking at the spreadsheet that you have here, earlier you had mentioned that the percentage was 87.89, but you thought it was 87.85, okay?
Please correct
what that is.
You corrected it, but you thought it was 80.5, okay, 87.9, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Liz came back and corrected it.
You know what it is? We were working off of, Liz got a lot of work done on the recap today, so that 0.4% all changed from that today, because those percentages all come from the recap. I mean, I can take the levy and divide it by the number of parcels. I can do it that way too. But you plug in the numbers in the recap, and the LA5 is going to come up with your percentage of residential and your percentage for each class. So that's where that 0.04%
right.
Okay. Came in as a variation.
I'm fine. Thank you.
Catherine.
No, I think, did you have a question?
Oh,
no, Mike. Just Mike.
Yes, thank you.
You know what? When I look this way, it looks
I
like
didn't.
We look a lot alike. It's okay. We get this a lot.
I just said I was.
Must be the hair.
Michael.
I'm having a good hair day right now. Thank you for looking into that means-based senior exemption. I do think it's worthy of a discussion. If that was the motivation of the board, why you gave that other presentation, which clearly didn't really fit what we were trying to, I believe, accomplish. But I think this is worthy of a further discussion in the future. But we are talking over in Reading that there are seniors that do apply for it and go through the process. They're expecting between $500 and $2,000 exemption. That's real money. That's something that I think our seniors would really appreciate us at least vetting the process. And now you mentioned about the application process for exemptions. Well, we offer exemptions here today, and
that's
there's an
correct.
Application process.
That's
is it much of a difference in the application process for the exemptions we offer?
Well, the exemptions that we currently have, which are our 17, our 41s, mm-hmm. those are state exemptions that the town has already locally adopted
mm-hmm.
with a value attached to that. For instance, our 41D, we have a $750 deduction on that off of their taxes. So their February in their May payment, because the law states that you can only deduct from the actual bills.
I was talking about the application process.
I'm getting there.
Okay.
So that application comes into our office, but it's already state approved. See, this is new. This is a whole new environment, which is why it has to go through legislation.
No, but the significance of the application.
So they have to create, actually, they have to create that application. Now, are they going to take information from, I mentioned Brookline. Brookline already has a residential exemption, no doubt. Why wouldn't they? Somerville has the residential exemption. So I'm sure you would take from other communities and add parts that fit to your community and remove other parts that don't.
Right, and
then it just has to be approved.
Yeah, I don't think we should disregard it because it is an application process.
Oh,
I think the seniors do it now, for at least the ones that take advantage of the exemptions we have now. So I would ask the board to please consider us, you know, maybe at a future meeting, putting this on the agenda and really vetting it. I think we owe it to the seniors to at least consider it. And when we're talking between 500 and 2,000 over in Reading, maybe we won't have that kind of a spread, but it could be something close to it, and I think it's worthy.
So just to clarify, this bill is bound to pass, but it's not passed yet, is that what you
mean? That's correct, Bob. It was filed October 13th. It was filed October
13th, 2016. Yeah, that's right. It's a home rule petition. That's going through the legislature.
So, and you're all on, you're not even, I don't think our legislation, I think we are off right now, aren't they?
They're always off. We're the only ones working.
I wasn't saying that. So this was just filed on October 13th. But they do expect, from what the assessor was telling me, they didn't anticipate any kind of delays, just, you know, they have to get back in session to go through it. Now, I know our association, the Assessing Association, has many bills in there, and some of them have sat there for 5 years or 6 years, and, you know, some of them go right through. So they're anticipating that this one will go right through.
So, Michael, maybe after the first of the year, we can invite Representative Jones, since his name is on here.
I did speak with him yesterday about it. He said he'd be more than happy to make the time to come in and give us more information on it. And if he doesn't, he certainly has representatives from his office that can make the time as well. So he said whatever we want to do, but I told him to hold off, because if we don't have the majority of the board interested in exploring something like this, then obviously we don't want to do it.
Well, clearly the board wasn't in support of the presentation I asked for a couple of weeks ago. Seems to be perhaps more focused on specific individuals with an issue rather than the value of real estate. And again, the benefit is not necessarily passed on to specific individual homeowners. It's passed on across the entire tax base.
Great.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions?
I do. I'm sorry. No, just going through, I was a little surprised. You know, last year we had a little discussion about, you know, you do your assessed value on our residential properties. I think you break it up into certain dollar values, if I'm correct, right? You have the homes that fall between, you talked about last year, the homes that fell between $350,000 in value and $550,000 in value. How much did those go up versus the homes that were $600,000 in value to $750,000 value? Did one go up 10% and the other go down 1%? I mean, I'd like to see that information again this year.
I do actually have all that information broken down. A lot of it I have off the top of my head because it is a reval year. I can tell you, very traditionally, anytime you're coming out of the recession, which we didn't really, this whole quadrant of the state really didn't get hit with the recession per se. I mean, there's a lot of communities that really lost a lot of valuation in their properties. We were very fortunate. We stayed very plateau. We even had some ups. But when you talk about delineation of our property values within certain ranges, what I found this year, and again, I'm going to say it, we're very traditional because of us coming out of the recession and the lower interest rates. My lower end homes, 500,000 and under, took the biggest hit this year, and it's 4%.
And they took the biggest hit last year, too.
And that doesn't mean, I don't want everyone to think that anyone that has a $490,000 home, theirs went up 4%, because it doesn't work exactly like that. There is a lot of analysis that has to go on in that. I mean, right down to, you know, your kitchen, your siding, your, do you have a stone foundation, or do you have a concrete foundation? There's a lot of data that goes in that to determine an actual valuation. Our higher-end homes pretty much stayed flat this year.
No, but that's how the assessed is the way you implement it, though, right? Because those homes essentially...
It's done from the sales.
Correct. That's what I was getting at. They're purchasing those homes
in
that range. So if you're a senior citizen living in a house that's valued at $400,000, because you've been in that house, you grew your family up in the house, you want to stay in that house, they're the ones that are, that's why, the only reason I bring it up is that it's another reason why I think we have to find some solution, because the homes that our seniors are living in are the ones that are increasing more than the ones that are living in that $900,000 range or the $800,000 range by percentage wise. And I just want the board members to know that, and I want the community to know that. You know, I think it's important
that
we address it.
Precisely why I asked for a review of the residential.
I know why, and I appreciate your motivation, but I just thought that exemption you were referring to was for more of a city community, not a rural community like us. And, you know, it's different. This
law is kind of changing and revising the residential exemption. So what used to only fit for multifamily communities such as Somerville, Malden, Boston, and Brookline, that new bill that is being in front of you, looking for final okay from legislation, is actually taking that exemption and revising it so that it does fit into the communities that, for the exact reason that you guys are saying, the elderly that has been in their homes that are valued due to market-driven values can possibly obtain some kind of relief. And that's what that bill is doing.
So, but it is sort of artificial when we say the average property went up X in North Reading. Well, okay, that's true, but what I think we should present and what I would like to see presented is it broken out in some kind of range. And you can work with Liz about what range that is, but the 350 to 550, I'd like to see that every year, because that's where our seniors are living. And we should have an idea how they're being, how their increases are compared to someone that's living in a house that's 750 to 900.
I do have that data, and it's broken out by neighborhood. Your neighborhood is a delineation of values.
Okay. That's good.
You know, I didn't put it in the presentation. It's not really part of the tax classification. I haven't shared it, absolutely. But it's not uncommon to see that kind of percentage change in certain years.
And the last comment I'll make, last year, same thing. In that range, they took the largest hit last year. So that's 2 years in a row. Matter of fact, I think if you go back and look at it, it's actually 3 years in a row. And if you look at the ones in the higher range, I don't think they've had over a 3 year average, the increase.
The last 2 years, which if you look at when the recession supposedly was 2012. So that would have been our values, because don't forget, my assessed values are always a year behind, because I need 12 months of data to analyze and have enough inventory. So for me to certify my values for FY17, I actually had to use 2015 sales. So when I say 2 years, that would go back to 20, 13 sales to put the increase predominantly, if you will, on the lower end.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yes.
Well, I don't know if this, I know what your point is, to be quite honest with you, because it's one of our, it's one of our goals is to sort of see what we can do to, you know, address the issue of remaining in place. But this doesn't seem to, this basically, to me, and I just read it briefly as it was provided by Deborah, is just giving seniors a credit. It doesn't seem like it's relating to the range of where their property falls. It's basically related to their age and qualifying them based on age.
Right.
That's the means test is all based on the information from the circuit breaker. So the circuit breaker is what's going to determine their eligibility to a certain degree, because for a senior to file a circuit breaker, they have to have the age requirement, they have to have a certain income, and their assets can only be within a certain range. It's means tested.
Yeah, my point that I was trying to make with it was, when we say the average home in North Reading went up 2%, okay, but where our seniors are living in that range, it went up 4%. That's the point I was trying to make.
Yeah.
Just to show you that their impact is pretty significant. And granted, they are getting value in those homes when they sell them. They're the most popular. I mean, they sell very quickly, and that's wonderful. But the ones that really want to stay here, and there are a lot of them, I just want us to all be aware of it. That's all. I'm just putting it out there for a point of reference. I think it's important.
Catherine, you have another question?
No, that was it. Thank you.
Before I leave, you guys have to
I'm not trying to rush you out.
Yeah. We're ready.
If anyone in the audience had any questions.
I'm ready. Let's go. Let's shift it all. Let's go.
Okay. Bob, yeah. I have a question.
Okay.
Debbie, I'm not sure if this is the right venue to ask this question, but the hours that the seniors put in for the $500 credit on their taxes.
Yeah.
Have we given any consideration, or has your department given any consideration to recommending an increase in that amount for the seniors?
We actually have just started that discussion, looking for the annual town meeting next year to possibly increase that. Now, one thing that we have to bear in mind, by increasing that means that my overlay, because that exemption comes out of my overlay. So you have to have that balance.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to prepare for an increase in those exemptions if it's coming out of a revenue, if it's coming out of an expenditure.
Okay, but you are having that conversation?
We are having that conversation. We have not gotten that far on it, to be honest with you. Just coming off of a reval year,
I understand that. So should we be pushing you to pick that up, or should we do something?
I wouldn't say that the board or myself need a push. As a matter of fact, Liz and I have had conversations about it too. It is a local adoption on the amount. You can increase that. You know, it's not that it can't be done. Like I said, it has to have a plan.
Yeah, what the board would need, just off the top, would be, what's that current cost of that program? You don't need to answer that
now.
I'm just saying that's something you need to bring to the table.
Yeah, but I mean that if I recall correctly, that really kind of equates to like $5 an hour, that thing.
In terms of the labor,
yes.
But
they can work up to 100 hours.
I understand that.
So.
But to get the $500, they have to get the 100, they have to put in 100 hours, which comes out to $5 an hour.
I don't know what that equals out to be honest with you. I know it has to be under $6.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, are we closing the hearing now? Are you closing the hearing now?
I will close the hearing. Hearing is closed. All right. Now we get to vote, or we can hold off.
No, we have the motions.
This is the motion.
You have the motion.
So Mr. O'Leary can come back this way. He can't until we do this.
Okay. Right.
I don't think he's following.
I know. Well, we should. So you can come back to the meeting.
Mr. Chairman, I move to establish a tax classification factor of 1.0 as recommended by the Board of Assessors.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? We have one member. We'll record.
We have two more, right?
Recused himself. Next.
Mr. Chairman, I move not to establish a residential exemption.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Not unanimous. Four. One.
Four.
Again.
Zero.
Zero.
One member is recused himself.
Mr. Chairman, I move not to establish a commercial exemption.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? One person recused himself. Next.
Mr. Chairman, I move to recommend the FY 2017 property tax levy at $47,342,229.22, which is $6,360.78 less than the levy limit.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Again, Mr. O'Leary has recused himself. Next.
Mr. Chairman, I move to recommend to the Board of Assessors that the FY 2017 tax rate be set at $16.13 per $1,000 of valuation.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Zero.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, through you. So I believe we had a second copy of another vote on the commercial exemption, but I think it's just a repeat. You do not need any more votes. Is that correct?
No, it is not.
Okay. And just for the record, Mr. Chairman, I'm advised by the finance director that there's a requirement that you sign off electronically. We expect we'll be able to do that tomorrow morning through the Department of Local Division of Local Services Gateway Program.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Carboni.
Thank you, Debbie.
Joined us.
Chairman, since you've already taken the votes, just in relation to the proposed legislation, it's pretty straightforward, really. What it is on the state income tax return, people are eligible to file for a circuit breaker, which is a separate schedule of the state income tax return, which is, again, means-based, and also a percentage of your income that is in relation to real estate taxes paid or rent paid. You're eligible for the circuit breaker. So in this case, it's a percentage of your income, which is real estate tax-based. What this is proposing is allowing the Board of Selectmen there to set an exemption of, and again, the maximum benefit of the circuit breaker bill and the circuit breaker schedule is $1,000. So someone on the state income tax can get a $1,000 break on the circuit breaker. This allows for the Board of Selectmen annually to set an exemption of anywhere from 50% of that to 200%, so either $500 to $2,000, somewhere in that range if they so choose. And then whatever amount that exemption produces is then shifted to the rest of the residential properties. So just a shift. But it is, again, the only people that are eligible are, it's like 25% of their income. Mm-hmm. The real estate tax is 25% of their income. They're eligible to, it has nothing to do with the assets that they have.
Which is far better than what I propose.
So it's
But by the same token, the shift still goes to other residential taxpayers.
Just like every other exemption.
Residential, not commercial.
But Mr. O'Leary, do you agree that it's at least worthy of our consideration?
Oh, it's worth taking a look at and see what it'd be. But I mean, maybe the Department of Revenue could tell us how many people in North Reading filed for and got, sorry, I can tell you how many I did. But there are quite a few. But again, it's not the maximum of $1,000. Some people, the maximum they can get is $1,000. Some people get $200. Some people get $800. Some people get the maximum of $1,000. So, pretty straightforward.
Okay, at this point, I'm going to reopen the public hearing on the Richdale Convenience Store, which is being continued from 11/7/16.
Wait, why are we reopening the public hearing?
Which is a transfer of package store wine and malt beverage license from Tedeschi to change the location.
Get more research.
So I think we left off with...
We're looking for additional input.
What?
I'll speak
additional input, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the hearing 2 weeks ago, the board had asked for additional reports from the police department relative to the traffic pattern. And so in the board's meeting packet for this evening's meeting are a report from the police department as to the number of calls to the location, as well as a report from the town engineer relative to the traffic pattern in the immediate vicinity of the proposed location, Richdale. And if you'd like, Mr. Chairman, I'll just read from the police department's report.
Okay, go ahead.
Mike, would you speak up?
Certainly. Phil, are we on for the audio in the room here?
I don't hear it.
There doesn't appear to be.
Ms. Herbert says no.
Yeah, you can't hear it, right? I can't even hear it. I'm sitting here.
How's that? Better? How's that? Better?
Test.
Can you guys hear me back there? Great. So I'll just summarize. The police department conducted a review of North Reading Police Department responses to the intersection of Main Street and Lowell Road by number 4. Included in the table below are a 1 year and a 5 year statistical look at our response to the retail complex at 4 Lowell Road. And we have a copy here for the applicant as well for the other report. So 1 year police response history, including police initiated responses to 4 Lowell Road, were 8 calls for service. 5 year police response history, including police initiated responses to 4 Lowell Road, there were 38 calls for service. 1 year motor vehicle crash history at Main Street by Lowell Road, 2 calls for service. The 5 year motor vehicle crash history at Main Street by Lowell Road, 11 calls for service. And the 5 year motor vehicle crash history for Lowell Road itself, 3 calls for service. And there were 5 documents that show detailed response information to support the statistical summary that I just referenced. Police response history to 4 Lowell Road was broken down by type of response, and the crash history breaks down by the crashes by month. And again, there was a detailed report that's been provided to the board in response to the request. And then, Mr. Chairman, if I may, a separate report that was put together by the Town Engineer and Public Works Director. Department of Public Works looked at the site at 4 Lowell Road, North Reading, regarding the current traffic and safety issues and the potential of increased traffic due to the possible approval of a liquor license at that location. The Town Engineer reviewed the site along with the Public Works Director to identify any possible concerns due to increased traffic. Currently, there are 2 parking lot access locations, one on the easterly side and one on the northerly side of the parking lot. The easterly entrance exit poses a potential conflict point due to its proximity to the intersection and the existing crosswalk. Increased use of this entrance exit could impact the flow of traffic in addition to pose increased safety concerns for pedestrians. Vehicles exiting from the easterly access looking to travel northerly need to cross 2 lanes of traffic, creating a safety concern and an impediment to traffic flow. In addition, neither is clearly marked as exit or entrance, and there is no turn restriction exiting the parking lot. The town engineer also contacted one of our traffic consultants informally to get some information from the Institute of Transportation Engineers Trip Generation Manual. This manual provides engineering data such as estimated trips to various locations for the purpose of determining impacts to adjacent road networks. The impact of additional traffic is not clearly defined based on the modification of use. further review and traffic analysis would be needed for more definitive results. Again, those are reports generated in response to the board's request. I would also note that there was a comment from the fire chief in the board's packet 2 weeks ago relative to some concerns in the business, and the fire chief has reported to me that the concerns he identified were all addressed prior to this meeting.
That's actually why this was continued for 2 weeks, was so that there were some concerns that would be addressed and that they were. Okay. I've listened to this report. First of all, we're not aware of all these police responses. Second, he's only been there about 3 years. Third, these mean nothing in a vacuum, because I'd like to see what other stores' reports are. I will say that I looked at the zoning map of the town of North Reading, and there's really only two business districts in the town of North Reading that a store could, that a license could go. And where it was at the Tedeschi's location, it was near another store 400 feet away, and there were three within 0.6 of a mile. In this particular location, there's only one a tenth of a mile away, and only two within 0.6 of a mile. I also did some radiuses, and any way you put it in the business district, in this Route 28 district, there would be, by definition, there would be other stores that are close. We have two stores across the street, 7 Main Street and 14 Main Street, across the street. That was approved. We have the Tedeschi location is 400 feet away from the speedway. One of those was approved. It begs the question, where would the public need be served? If this location is not appropriate, where would it be served? And unless the board's taking the position that they don't need all the quota licenses, which is legitimate. I mean, you know, they say, well, we don't need all the quota licenses. But assuming that they do, there's no other location, reasonably, that would be any less densely populated with liquor license than this was. And this is one of the best, I think this would be one of the least densely populated. So I don't want to relitigate the whole hearing last week. We were here for quite a bit of time. We had the back and forth between the old location and this location. Only thing I'll note is this is the fourth time we're here within the last 3 months. This individual is in good faith. He entered into a purchase and sale agreement to purchase a license. He tried the existing location, and the board said, well, it's no longer a traditional convenience store. And we went two hearings for that one. Now we come back and try to place it in a traditional convenience store, and there's more objections. You know, there's not a public need. And perhaps there's not. But my position is, if there's not here one here, there's not one anywhere at the town of North Reading at this point, because this is not clustered like many of the others, including the existing location, is closer than the nearest one here and is more within a radius of 0.6 of a mile. And again, you know, we did address the issues that we were asked to address. So I mean, I'll answer any questions. I don't think there's anything more we can say. The board says there's not a public need. There's not a public need. I mean, that's what the board says. But
Mr. Gilbert,
through the chair, is it the applicant's intention to operate one establishment in North Reading with an alcoholic beverage license? Or is it the intention to operate only one?
That's all he can. You're only allowed to have an interest in a liquor license and one license in a town, two in a city, 7 in the state, but you can't have more than one interest in them.
So it would be his intention to only have one?
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Even if it weren't, he couldn't, but yeah, that's his only intention.
Would members?
Mr. Chairman,
As I pointed out at the last meeting, this particular location had already applied for an application back in 2000. It may not be the same owner, but the same location, same venue. There were considerable concerns back then, which were expressed. The concerns and the location and the need hasn't been changed or considerably altered in any particular way. The applicant at the time, again, appealed the decision of this board. The board denied the application. It went to the ABCC for a hearing, and the ABCC upheld the decision of the local licensing board, which is the Board of Selectmen, at that particular time. And again, as far as this particular location, and again, I wasn't present for the continuation of the previous hearing on August 22nd, and maybe I would have had a different opinion. But again, the location and the proximity and the way that the configuration of the intersections at Route 28 and North Street are far different than the ones from Route 28 and Lowell Road. That being said, it would appear, and I would anticipate, that the applicant would anticipate an increase in traffic at the location. Otherwise, why else would you be doing this? And again, that could pose some additional hazard as far as the entrance and egress in this particular piece parcel of land. Again, as far as the meeting the public's needs, again, there's a full retail business 2 doors away. Neighbors had previously, a resident had previously expressed opposition to it. I didn't hear from necessarily in this particular case, but it hasn't changed. And you know, that being said, I can't see myself personally changing my opinion from several years ago when the application was first put forth. So I, for one, will not be in support of the transfer.
Mr. Yule?
Yes. Steve, you're referring to a report that was done in 2001?
Thereabouts.
It'd be about 15 years ago. Some residents had voiced their opinion that they didn't think that the liquor store should be there. Is that right?
I think there were three or four that actually came to the hearing, right?
Has anybody come forward this time?
Not at the public hearing, but I did speak to a couple of residents who weren't able to attend. And again, the public hearing is actually closed, so they weren't able to attend. But I have spoken to a couple of residents down there who were involved previously, and they haven't changed their opinion.
No.
But again, they weren't present at the
public hearing. No, I appreciate that. As far as public need is concerned, I've expressed this before, and I believe the public really decides whether there's a need or not. An establishment such as Richdale or Tedesco's or 7-Eleven or what have you, if there is no need, the public won't go there, and that would impact the establishment negatively. But I think it should be left up to the public to decide that. So in that sense, I'm in support of the license being awarded, because if it will improve the revenue at the business, therefore it should help our town from a tax basis. Going back to 2001, it just seems to me such a long time ago to have any weight on this subject now. I would be in support of it, leaving it up to the free market, so to speak, to decide that whether we need one or not.
Ms. Mattelli?
I actually think it's incumbent upon us to make that determination for the constituents we represent here. And I just wanted to make sure that Attorney DeMarcus is aware that when, I know you weren't at the initial hearing, Attorney Devlin, I believe, represented the applicant.
That's correct.
Yes.
From our office, yes.
But it was not just the fact of the permanent deed restriction on the convenience store that was the reason why that vote was taken to deny the application. It was also based on the lack of public need for the sale of liquor at that establishment. And that was a basis for the denial of that petition at that time.
Can I respond to that? Public need doesn't come into play at an existing location. In other words, it's a new location that does like this, but not an existing location. Public need doesn't come into effect. So the basis of the decision would properly have to have been on the deed restriction. You can't, in other words, if you approve a speedway, let's say just speedway comes in and they want to do a transfer, you can't say, well, it was not public need. We've already made that decision and it's just a transfer. So that's why I said when I said it last time, it was based on the deed restriction, because it had to have been based on the deed restriction by law, by the alcoholic beverage laws. So in what happened was, it was just an unusual case. Tedeschi was bought by a competitor across the street, and the competitor said, look, we're buying you because we don't want a convenience store there. We would have loved to have stayed there. And the landlord, I think, this year that I saw him, he would love to have had us stay there. We had signed a lease. But the board said, no, we just couldn't bend it enough to become a convenience store. And that would have been a close question legally, but we said, look, the board, we understand, the board has a legitimate thing. They rented it to a convenience store, now they don't want it to be something else. And so I would take it that would be the basis of your decision, because once you grant a license, you can't go back and revisit the issue of public need.
And again, I respectfully disagree with you. I was at that meeting, and I do know the reason why we took the vote, and that was a part of that vote. We're not here to hear that petition, because that was denied at that meeting, and the time to appeal that is gone. So we're on to a different location.
Yeah, we're not appealing that.
But even the fact of this location, we would have to look at it as a brand new application and consider the facts of the application, and even just aside from the fact that there's an establishment right across the street from this new proposed location, that is a basis. The public need doesn't exist, and I think that it is important for us to consider traffic implications and the potential traffic issues that might arise, although I think I was pretty straightforward the last time you were here with respect to that, there being a lack of public need based on the number of retail establishments in the vicinity. And I don't know that anything that I've heard here today would actually change that. It solidified that impression for me.
Mr. Prisco, any comments?
I'll just say that, you know, like a license here in the town of North Reading are not an entitlement. They are a privilege. And we don't have a lot of privileges here on the board, but this is one that we get the opportunity to voice our opinion and to have an actual vote on. In this particular case, I think Mrs. Minupelli is correct. The location where you want to place this liquor license with proximity to others doesn't make a lot of sense. The town is growing. We don't have a lot of these liquor licenses, so we have to look at it from an economic development standpoint, and I think it's in our best interest for the town to have this liquor license available for the future. I don't think it serves the town well by having it in this location. And then Mr. O'Leary brings up a wonderful point, the history of it, and it was obviously very, very well vetted back then. I wasn't around, but the safety thing has to be addressed, and I have to assume our traffic flows have increased over the last 10 years. They haven't decreased. So that means if the issues were there, existed 10 years ago, then they've exacerbated over that time frame even worse. So I'm not going to change my mind. I'm going to be voting against the transfer.
Okay. I've given a lot of thought into this thing, and as much as a board, we've taken a position to be as pro-business as we can, and that clearly Route 28 is our business district. It just seems to me that I just can't get past the point. There's a liquor store across the street. I haven't heard from any residents in the area. Steve O'Leary has reported that back some time ago, there was before I got on the board, I think, there was a request for a liquor license for the same location, although albeit a different individual or owner. I just can't support this particular request, and it's primarily based on we have adequate places for people to buy alcohol on Route 28, and I don't see a need for another one. The fact that there was a liquor license up at Tedeschi's, that was granted long before I got on the board too, so I think at this point we have sufficient services for the community, and I will not be supporting this request. Do any board members have any other comments before I ask for a vote? Mr. Yule.
I'm obviously going to be in the minority here, and with all due respect to my fellow board members, I really think that the public is intelligent enough to decide whether such a store, such an establishment, would be used, they would go to. I think that it would be their intelligence to say, you know what, I'm not going to go to this liquor store. I'm not going to go to this store because they have liquor. We have too many. I think we could leave that up to them. I think it's important for them to be able to be given the opportunity to make that decision on their own. With regard to using the intersection and the increase of traffic and so on, well, traffic is going to increase no matter what on that corner. All right, now I have in the past have voted against giving a liquor license to a restaurant because of the location of that restaurant. And it was a very, very, very dangerous intersection because you couldn't see cars coming. That's not the same thing at the corner of Lowell and Route 28. But traffic is going to increase anyway. So I realize I'm not going to, you know, dissuade my fellow board members. And I think that their intent is benevolent and well-intentioned. I guess it's just a matter of a disagreement. But again, let the market decide whether they should have a license or not. So.
Any other comments? I'll ask for a motion. Mr. Minipelli, based on the fact that I think it's 4-1 and in favor of denying the license request.
Mr. Minipelli, Mr. Chairman. I move to deny the application.
Not that late.
I move to deny the application for everyone's mixing everyone's name. Mr. Chairman, I move to deny the application for transfer and change of location for a package store wine and malt beverage license to Bakintianadian LLC, DBA Richdale Convenience Store, 4 Lowell Road, Unit 1, and further move that the board adopt the following findings. That based on the reports presented to the board, the license would likely increase traffic at a location that is already shown to pose hazardous traffic conditions when entering and exiting the premises. That there is already a full retail off-premises alcoholic beverages business, New England Beverage, located two buildings away from that location that adequately services that part of town. That neighboring residents have previously expressed opposition to an alcoholic beverage license at this location. That these factors make the proposed location inappropriate for this license, and that this license is not in the public need.
Second.
Second by Mr. Prisco. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Opposed.
Record the motion is 4-1. Thank you. Anyone here for public comment?
Did you?
I was second, yes.
Next item on our agenda is to discuss the health insurance for 2017.
Mr. Gilbert.
Mr. Gilbert, sorry.
Promoted.
Because I've only been here since 4 o'clock.
I don't.
If I may recuse myself from this, thank you.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, through you, Brian Adams from NFP, our health insurance advisor, is here. The intention of this discussion is simply to provide the board a status update with regard to the trends for our plan, which, as the board knows, was modified effective July 1st of this year. So we have a presentation that we'll go through. It was in the packet as well. It has been cleared for compliance with HIPAA requirements, so it will be as detailed as possible for public discussion. Very similar presentation was reviewed earlier this afternoon with the members of the Insurance Advisory Committee as well. Again, intended to provide a status update. We'll also have a brief presentation and conversation relative to the renewal of the senior plan effective January 1st. And with that, once he's ready, I will turn it over to Mr. Adams to review of the presentation.
Technology.
It's in a packet for tonight's meeting. Yes.
Yeah, no. I said we have it.
We got it at 4 o'clock.
Yeah.
A lot of this is going to be repetitive for a few folks, but we'll kind of breeze through this. I'm just going to stand here so I can read the TV. My lesson first meeting.
You might want to use a mic so they can pick you up.
You
can stand a little bit. Hold the mic, maybe.
Unfortunately.
A little bit of.
But you can point over here if you want.
Okay. Maybe not so good with technology.
Are you listening to?
So just to recap, this slide here is showing what the prior year plan was and what we moved to on July 1st. Keeping in mind that this is for your active population only, active employees and non-Medicare retirees. So on this slide here, we're looking at two time periods. The column in the middle is your most recent 12-month. Column on the right is your prior 12-month. When they talk about renewals, they're going to look at two time periods, two 12-month periods. What this is showing, and I'm going to move in onto these red lines here, your total cost versus premium was at 107%. It's now at 101.2. Once we remove the pooled claims, and what those are, just any claim over 105,000 gets pulled out of your experience, your loss ratio drops to 99.3. Ideally, what we want is right at 100%. Your total claims versus premium, this is just your raw loss ratio,
was at 90.3 for the most recent 12 months. It's at 84.3%. So the total cost on the bottom here, the total cost PMPM, and PMPM just means per member per month charge, did decrease by about 7%. This next slide here is just a look, a snapshot at your large loss claims or anything that's over $50,000. The top box is your most recent 12, bottom is your prior 12. All this is showing is your top claimant had a total charge of $183,000, $78,000 of which was pulled out, so you're not responsible for those claims. That claimant is no longer active, could mean any number of things. Your claimant five is as well is no longer active, but you'll note that's only at $86,000. So there's that's none of that. All that experience is going to be used in your calculation. Bottom half is your prior 12 months. So you'll note that you're currently at $946,000 in large claims. It's down slightly from one a little over a million. And when we talk about renewal, this top time period is going to be used more. It's going to be more credible in your renewal, so that's going to be worth about 60%. Bottom's going to be worth about 40%. This slide is just showing the total claims versus premiums. July 2016 is a new plan, so that's with the new plan design, the $300 deductible, 900 family. You'll note the total claims is in the maroon bar, and the monthly premiums are in the gray. What happens with this is when we replace month to month, so we're going to add August, but what happens is August 15 will then come off. So it depends what we're replacing it as opposed to what comes off. Now this is just looking at claims through July, and I don't have this slide, but the other slide that we do have August claims, and August claims did tick up. So your loss ratio for the month of August of 2016 is 121%. It's nothing worth panicking right now. That's almost certainly a large loss, so a lot of that claim will come out of your experience. But what that means is that you're going to add a month that's going to have a higher claim, and you're going to lose a month that has a lower claim. Again, trend. We're looking at medical trend in the ballpark of 6.9%. Last year it was 7.67, so medical trend is actually ticking down slightly. Pharmacy trend is where we're seeing an uptick. Last year you were at about 14.2%. We are projecting pharmacy trends to be roughly 16%, 16 to 17% in that ballpark. Pharmacy trend is going to be composed of a couple of things, your core drugs as well as specialty pharmacy drugs. Those are going to be your injectables, things of that nature. Specialty pharmacy trends are running roughly 23-24%. So when you combine specialty and regular, you're looking at about 16% in pharmacy trends. Total combined.
Just hold a second. Something just came to mind. Is the pharmacy is not necessarily more people needing prescriptions. It's the fact that this whole
EpiPen?
Yeah. Things like that have just gone out of the roof.
It used to cost $100, it's now $600. Yeah. That type of thing. And new to market drugs.
I've noticed some prescriptions that I take that were in category one have gone to two, one's gone to three, one is not available anymore, we're not covering it. So. Yep.
Well, that's the one benefit with the Harvard Pilgrim is it's an open formulary, so it's still going to be covered, it's just going to move up a tier. Mm-hmm. So, and specialty pharmacy, there's things called injectables. There's one particular injectable that's for cholesterol. Instead of taking the Lipitor or the Simistatin, you get one injection. Well, a 30-day supply of Lipitor is roughly $350. One injection of the new drugs is about $1,400 to $1,500. So it's a big difference in costs. And there's no quantified, in my opinion, there's no quantified improvement in outcomes. Any questions on this? So the combined trend, both medical and pharmacy is running roughly about 9.5%. On top of that, we're adding about 2% for ACA charges, Affordable Care Act charges. So we're expecting around 11.5% in trend. Now back here, you'll note your PPM is down 7%. So we're expecting a fairly positive renewal.
Just a question, another question, which we didn't discuss earlier, is are we still considered a Cadillac plant?
Even with the 300, you're, yes. You still have a very benefit-rich plan.
When does that penalty come into play? I know they kicked it out. I thought it was 2018 now.
2020.
Oh, now it's 2020.
Yeah. Incidentally, what's going to happen in 2020?
Nobody knows.
It's another presidential election year, so who knows what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And depending on what happens with the new administration, the Cadillac tax could go away.
Yeah.
We're still monitoring what's going to happen at the federal level. Anyone that tells you today they know what it's going to look like tomorrow is not being, in my opinion, honest. So on the Medicare Enhanced, which is the senior renewal, again, the Tufts plan is renewed. There's no problems with that. It did go up. Only 11 people are on the plan. Your Medicare Enhanced plan is a supplemental plan. This is going to be where the majority of your folks are, about 246, actually now it's about 250 members enrolled in this plan. The incurred claims through May was 366,000. Of the previous 12 months, the most recent 12 months, it's 468,000. So the loss ratio on this plan went from 62.21 and it jumped up to 90.62. So it's about a 30% increase in claims. We did go back to Harvard Pilgrim to try to get this reduced. So they added two more months of data to the plan. We were hoping that instead of it being 90, it was going to come down or moderate a little, maybe in the high 80s. It actually went the opposite direction. The new loss ratio is 92%. So it continues to deteriorate. So the percent increase, the original percent increase, a capped increase from Harvard Pilgrim was 14.8. We were able to get them down to 12.5. The formula increase, if I'm not mistaken, was about 18.5, 19% in that ballpark. So Harvard Pilgrim did issue the 14.8, did go down to 12.5. With a 92% loss ratio, they wanted to change that, but they're keeping the rate at the 211.89.
Just a question. That's such a significant jump, right? How do we explain?
It's the claims dollars. It's the utilization. So you went from $366,000 up to $468,000. The other component to that is last year there was an increase in your Part B deductibles, so the plan now pays a little bit more. And it's a very benefit-rich product.
Yeah.
Any questions, comments, concerns? The Aetna Part D, this is your prescription drug benefit. The current rate is $154.70. The new 2017 rate was originally came in at $173.72, which is a 12% increase. Excuse me. We were able to get Aetna to reduce it. So the new negotiated rate is $165.53 for no changes in pharmacy, other than mandated changes, which have no impact to the members. So gap coverage went from $3,300 to $3,700. Catastrophic went from $4,850 to $4,950. Members pay the co-payment straight throughout those. Once they get out into catastrophic coverage, they pay 5% of the cost, not to exceed the co-payment level. So the as-is renewal without any changes came in at a 10%. We are recommending adding a $10 office visit to primary care physician and specialists without changing the prescription drug benefit. That brings that rate down further from 10% to 4.918%. And again, this plan is going to run January 1st through the end of December of 2017.
Mr. Chairman, through you.
Yes.
And just a note, that was at our direction because of the fact that we're carrying in the fiscal year 2017 budget a renewal percentage of 5%
for the senior plan. So at the 10%, you know, we are far outside the budget parameters for the fiscal year. This 4.91% gets us within those parameters as a result of the plan design change with the institution of the $10 office visit copay.
And this is for the retiree plan?
For the Medicare-eligible Harvard Pilgrim plan only.
And that the town share is 50-50. 50%
correct.
Town share, 50% retiree, as opposed to the active employee is 70-30.
Correct. Yep. So next slide is we took a look at the utilization. What we came down to, and based off the last 12 months, there's members on the Medicare Enhanced had an estimated annual visits of 12.9 visits. We'll call it 13 visits. So they would pay the $10 for that. But what we did here on the right-hand side is the current monthly rate for the members. So this is just the member's share, not the town share. The town share is the same. But the current monthly is $171.49. If we did nothing, it would be $188.71. The $10 office visit went to $179, so there's a savings to the member there of almost $10 per month. So the increase from current as is would be $17.22 a month or $206 a year. By increasing the co-payments, instead of it being $17.22, it would be $8.43. So the increase to the member is almost $10 per month less. So the added cost of the visits is $129. The annual premium savings for office visit co-payments is $106. Any questions, concerns, issues? So the 2017 Medicare Enhanced with PDP rate, this is just confirming. Of course, there's two components to it. There's the medical and the Part D. This is with a $10 office visit, inpatient, outpatient, diagnostic tests, emergency room are all going to remain covered in full. Prescription drug co-payments unchanged at 5, 10, 25, 25 for 30-day. 5, 10, 25 not applicable for 90-day via mail or retail. The total medical rate is $194.31. The Part D rate of $165.53. The total combined rate of $359.84, which brings us to the 4.9% within budget. Questions, concerns, issues? Just a little bit of historical information. What we did is we took a look at your previous year plans. This is at 10%, so this number is actually going to come down on the right-hand side. Even with the PDP, what this is showing is going to the prescription drug Medicare Part D plan. We're still far below where we were previously. We did get a quote to go back to Harvard Pilgrim Drugs, and it was like an 80%, 85% increase, so we knew that that was not going to happen. A little bit on some benchmarking studies where you compare. We use the town of Winchester as an example. It's a similar town with a similar type of plan, and we compared it as well to the GIC Medicare Enhanced rate through Harvard Pilgrim and the GIC Unicare OEM. So even with a $10 office visit, and again, this shows you your as is, so the $10, this would have $10 for the PCP office, and the rate would be $3.50 something. Your benefits are still significantly better, and more importantly, your pharmacy benefits are significantly better than both GIC plans as well as the town of Winchester's. Comments, issues, concerns?
You look like you want questions from
us. Mr. Chairman, through you.
Yes.
So again, we just offered this as an update to our insurance advisory committee earlier today. We offer this as an update for the community with regard to the status of things. There was obviously a lot of discussion that took place concerning plan design for our active employees earlier this year. You know, we've committed to, as a result of some of the challenges with that process, to maintain an ongoing discussion with our employees. This is the first step in that. There'll be more data that will become available as 2016 becomes 2017, and we can look at our options. You know, certainly we went through the challenge of a plan design change, which had an impact on our employees. The other tools that are available to us are, of course, testing the market with regard to going out for proposals, and that's something that we'll review in further detail with the board. But we just put this out there as notification, you know, that we are monitoring this. Again, our employees are aware that we're monitoring it. There will be a change in the senior plan for retirees. We know it'll be a difficult change, but it's one that's unfortunately necessary in order to ensure that we live within the town's means for the fiscal year 2017 budget. So thank you for the opportunity to make this presentation.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Just in relation to the senior plan, I mean, obviously, I mean, the retirees plan. The, you know, obviously, the retirees of the town are North Reading are truly on a fixed income, and some of them have been retired for a substantial amount of time, and their incomes are pretty low. And as far as their annual cost of living increase, it's only based on about $14,000 a year. The first $14,000 is what they get us. They might get a $300, $350 increase annually, you know, on their pension. What we're talking about here is asking them to share some additional costs. And again, they're actually bearing more of a cost than the town and the taxpayers are under this proposal. You know, the premium, as we pointed out earlier, is 50-50. But when you add a copay, again, which results in about a 5% increase for both sides here. But when you add the copays, the average is about $130. But it's certainly, you can't truly average that because some of our retirees have greater usage than others. I mean, so the impact on some of the retirees is going to be more significant and potentially eat up the cost of living increase that they get. So it doesn't feel good to have to do this. And, but by the same token, it's still a very good plan that we offer. It's far better than anything on the GIC, which certainly was one of the board's options to go to, which I would not recommend. Because it would just increase the cost for both the retirees and the town and the employees. But that being said, I think it's important to note that we recognize that, you know, we're asking our retirees to take on an additional financial burden in order to help us contain the costs and still provide the level of services and retain the number of employees that we have in order to deliver the services that the public expects. So from that standpoint, you know, we certainly appreciate it, and I know they don't particularly appreciate it, but we think the net difference between the premium savings and the additional out-of-pocket costs helps minimize the adverse impact on those retirees. So, you know, it's with some great reluctance that I, as a member of the board, you know, support the recommendation of the town administrator and our consultants to change the plan design for retirees and institute the $10 copay, which again, it doesn't seem like much, but for someone on a fixed income, it can have a substantial impact. So I just didn't want the opportunity to pass by without noting the fact that the retirees are going to be saddling more of the financial burden than the town and the taxpayers. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So noted. Anyone else? Mr. Frisco?
Yeah, I just want to make sure it's clear that, you know, we did look at so many other options, and this is clearly the best. Unfortunately, it does have a negative impact on them, but considering all the other options, this is the less of the evils. And I just see, and everyone knows, this is a trend that's going to continue. It's really hard for us as a little town to really find a solid solution that is a positive one until this is faced at the federal level, at the state level, national level. We have to continue to find options like this to get through this. This is a very challenging time. But I do have a question about, you had mentioned a couple times now today about the prescription, and you kept saying that our plan offers a really good prescription benefit. Is it any different than what they've seen in the past year? And if there is a savings, do they see any savings from what we've offered in the last year's plan?
I'm sorry.
In the prescription. The prescription.
Yep.
Did it change at all? I don't think it changed, right?
The copayments did not change.
No, it didn't.
No.
Okay.
Tiering can always change every year, so there may be some drugs that are currently on tier one that may be moved to tier two.
Yeah.
conversely, there are some that are in tier two that may move down to tier one.
Look, you've only brought it up a few times. You kept saying we offer, this is a really good prescription plan.
Yep.
And I wasn't sure. I just wanted to make sure I was clear. It hasn't changed.
No. Nope.
It was really good last year, too.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
As you recall, Michael, we purposely, when we reviewed our options, we said that our retirees may be more reliant on prescription costs.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, we did.
The unfortunate part about it is, even though we haven't changed the copays on it, but the drug companies have done a fair amount of shifting over the past couple of years. And that we can't predict going into next
right.
year yet.
Well, just to clarify, on 1/1/2016, we did have Harvard Pilgrim drugs. We shipped to the Aetna Medicare Part D plan. So the 30-day supply was the same. The 90-day supply was slightly different from the Aetna to the Harvard Pilgrim. But there's no recommended changes for 1/1/17 in terms of copayment design.
We haven't had any feedback from our senior, from our retirees on any negative feedback on that plan.
No. The only feedback we had is when the actives renewed and some of the retirees got the letter and they came to the health fair up in arms because they thought they were losing their Aetna PDP, which I immediately sent them to Michael. I don't know if they came in or not. But.
Yeah. No, but this is difficult. We don't want to do it. That's the best alternative we have.
As you pointed out, if we were to tackle the prescription drug portion of the plan, it would have had, would have a substantial impact on more of the retirees
right.
and potentially higher costs for
right.
them beyond the $10 copay. So, as you pointed out, this is the lesser of evils in relation to the choices that we have to make. And, while it's unfortunate, I think we're still very fortunate, and the retirees here are very fortunate in relation to the benefits that we're providing to date and have been able to continue to provide, and we hope to do it. So there's been an awful lot of time and energy and the resources expended throughout the year, not just on an annual basis, but throughout the year to analyze the history and the what's happening in the performance so that we can provide the best possible care that we can for and plans for our retirees.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much for all your
Thank
work.
You.
You're welcome.
We're going to pass over this annual municipal review of town owned land.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, just very briefly.
No.
Okay. Okay. Look. It just says you have to review it. It doesn't say what that means. It just says review it.
Let's review it. It should take all of us about 38 seconds.
Do we need a both of us? What is this
about? Yeah. What's that?
I don't know how we can review it in 1 minute.
Okay. No. Do we need a vote on this?
Sure. Yes.
We do.
Perhaps
sure.
A vote to approve the plan design change instituting the $10 office visit.
Okay.
There's no motion for that, by the way.
No.
No.
Our clerk says we do not have a motion.
The motion would be to approve the institution of a $10 office visit copay for the retiree plan effective January 1st, 2017.
Mrs. Megapelli made it, and I'll second it.
Who seconded it?
I'll second it.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. I think we've discussed this thing so I'll ask for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
And one abstention.
And one abstention, Mr. Yule, in this case. Thank you. Okay, we have annual municipal review. Mr. Gilberto, were you going to make a statement?
Just a very brief note that at the last time we did this, the board asked that we try to put the information in a more useful format. And what we have done is segregated out the land for which we receive responses and a land for which we did not receive any responses. And if you look in the list, we prioritized it so that at the top of the list are the parcels for which we got the most response from departments. And it scales back down to those for which we only got one response. And then there's a line drawing, and everything below the line, we didn't get any response from the town departments. That's separate and distinct from the land that we are using for some public purpose right now, and there's really no chance that we're going to do anything to convey it.
Yeah.
The final thing I'll note is we do have one request from a resident who was before the board roughly a month ago, interested in exploring the use of a parcel. He's not looking to make it, he's not looking to develop it other than to put an accessory structure on it as he represented it to us. There's a procedure that's called for under the town bylaw that the board needs to follow if it wishes to entertain that. I'm not saying that we need to start that procedure tonight, but there is a procedure that's required to be followed if we're going to entertain it. And that was all I wanted to add.
And where's that property?
It's on Oak Street, I believe. It's on the, I know the parcel, it's map 17, parcel 1, and I believe it's Oak that it's located on. It's down the end.
Towards the end?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah, I see it. Yeah, Oak Street. 3963 square feet.
It sounds about right. It's a small lot.
Yeah, I see that.
Parcel, map 17, parcel 1.
Yep.
So I just note that again.
Okay, so we have a complete listing, and we have it in order of
most interest.
Responses from town department.
Town department response, that's right. I just note that. I'm not necessarily requesting any action, just to tell you what you have in front of you.
And below the lines, no response.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Could you put the actual spreadsheet in Dropbox?
Certainly.
Not the PDF.
Right, the Excel document. I've learned that's what you mean when you make that request.
Yeah. That way it can be sorted a number of different mm-hmm. ways. And might be helpful to look at it in different ways. Okay, any further discussion regarding municipal review of time or land? It's something we need to put on the agenda to move this individual's request forward.
We can take up the individual's request as a standalone item.
I mean, right. Really, that's a good idea.
So one of the things you and I talked about last Wednesday was kind of laying out agenda in a longer term and taping, not the little things that come up, you know, each week, but topics that we need to cover. And a lot of them get kicked, the king gets kicked down the road, that we just pick a date and put it in for the meeting, whether it's February or March or April. And we make sure that that is a priority on that particular night, along with whatever else has come about. We'll try to balance the items so that we're not here until midnight, especially when we start at 4 o'clock.
Well, we started at 4 tonight.
So we can do a better job there. Anyone has any okay. suggestions regarding that? We have minutes.
Mr. Chairman, there may be some executive session minutes that require discussion, so it might be my suggestion that we move that to a future meeting for discussion.
Okay. That means that...
November 7th, I'm told there may not be an issue, so that would leave the board able to act on November 7th, okay. Regular and executive session.
All right. I'll entertain a motion for the minutes of November 7th regular session.
I'm sorry, just let me get to that if you don't mind. Minutes of those. Okay. Can I just make an issue regarding this or? Discuss before I made a motion.
Yes, and my change, if not.
Yes, okay. Yes, and I think it was pretty. It was in the context of that public hearing. It's not reflected why we continued it, and there were pretty specific reasons why the board continued the public hearing on that license petition that had to do with the fire.
Why don't we hold it then?
Okay.
Why don't you give your suggestions to Jane? Okay. Cover us, and then that's a good idea.
So mm-hmm. not so we're not gonna we'll pass mm-hmm. over that today.
Are you talking about the license that we just
yes, that's good idea.
All right. And we won't do the executive session either then.
You're talking about the public hearing.
Right.
We're gonna that we just reconvene the executive session to discuss the March, September, October executive session minutes.
We're not voting on the November 7th executive? No?
No, can we?
If there's no issue, we can vote.
There's no issue. If there's no issue, sure.
I didn't see anything.
Okay.
No.
So Mr.
Motion to approve the executive session minutes of November 7th.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the November 7th, 2016 executive session minutes as written.
Second.
Second by Mr. Ure. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous.
And was there an issue with, I didn't see any, but was, did anyone have an issue with the September 19th executives?
Well, that's got the, that's related to the discussion regarding March
28th. Yeah, they're tied in together.
It relates, to, relates to March 28th.
Oh. Okay, oops. So how about the October 3rd ones? That was the one that we did address. It's just one slight.
I asked you to tell me what the change was.
Sorry, I thought I did that. Okay.
We can resolve it between now and the next meeting.
It's pretty, like four words.
So the next meeting.
Okay.
We can't amend it in open session because it's executive session. Yeah.
So the other one's waiting, the executives. Yes. Okay, I see.
So you're looking for a vote to release the executive session minutes of the 1998 to 2015. Have they all been reviewed?
Mr. Chairman, through you. So we have been going through a process of reviewing minutes for release. And we've gone through a series of years, as you see identified here. It's a lot of minutes. And it's a lot of portions of minutes because there are sections of minutes that are just not able to be released or may never be able to be released. We've created a separate Dropbox folder that we referred you to in the meeting notes where all those minutes are located. Not necessarily expecting that the board members have gone through all of those minutes tonight. We just want to call to attention that those minutes are there, and we would like to proceed with releasing minutes. Again, we don't have a specific motion for such a release to happen this evening, but we would just call it to the board members' attention. There's quite a bit of work that's been done by the vice chair, and I believe by the chairman as well, in reviewing some minutes from past years, and I think we're on our way to getting those minutes released. I would just refer you to them being there, and we intend to start putting them on the agendas for release beginning with the next meeting.
So when we do that, we're just going to list the date?
There'll probably be a group motion, maybe by year.
Right.
And it will make a statement as reflecting portions of the minutes because there are areas that will not be released.
In that case, how are we dealing with the portions? Are we creating a document just with the items we're releasing?
That's correct. So we would release and post ultimately, or we would only release the redacted versions of the minutes.
All right.
Yes, for educational purposes for me, what would constitute an executive session meeting not being allowed to be released?
Mr. Chairman, through you. So there may be certainly anything that relates to ongoing collective bargaining. We wouldn't release for strategic reasons. Anything relating to ongoing litigation, we would not release for strategic reasons. Anything related to a medical issue, we would not release. Anything that's directly related to a personnel-related matter, it would not be a public record, we would not release. And there may be a matter that of general privacy. I can't envision there being many of them, but a matter of general privacy that we're not able to release as well. Those would be examples of categories. I can tell you there's a lot of information that can be released, right, you know, for the public purpose that's been identified there. But there are certain areas that the open meeting law or other laws would indicate that those information is not public.
And in the case of negotiations, okay, that are handled in executive session, just using 1998 as the oldest year that you have here, would there be any negotiated discussions not be allowed to be brought, released?
I think that really becomes a policy question through you, Mr. Chairman. I think that becomes a policy question for the board, in that some communities opt to indicate that strategy continues from one negotiation stretch to the other, And so the board can make a determination it does not wish to release strategy information from previous negotiations. That's an example that I could cite. It could be a situation where, you know, the matter has been resolved and it's a unique standalone matter that's not necessarily, that would not necessarily transcend the negotiations, and maybe that could be released. Speaking with town council, and I think he was present with the board, obviously, you know, that's something that's kind of up in the air from a standpoint of the guidance at the state level, that there is some level of discretion for the board. I think the most important thing that I can note here, and I'm kind of looking to Selectman Manupelli as well to affirm this, I think that there's a desire to see that the review is happening and that minutes are being released. It doesn't mean that they all need to be released, but they want to see that the practice is being followed.
In the process, would it be valuable to put the executive session minutes that are not proposed to be released in a separate folder, just so the board members can go back and look at them if they want?
Yes, the intention would actually be to put all of the executive session minutes into folders for the board members to have access to while they're not released. The difference being the public session minutes, once approved, are posted on the internet, so those are readily available to the entire community. But that based on your suggestion, that's what we've been doing, and that I think that's what we have done with the minutes that are in the Dropbox folder by year, if I remember correctly.
Where would we find those? So it's on the Board of Selectmen, so where?
So if you're in the Dropbox folder, the so-called homepage, yeah, down the bottom, unreleased executive session minutes is a new folder.
And where is that again?
It's in Dropbox, the homepage of Dropbox, if you will, where there's a long list of years with meeting packets, and that goes through a whole bunch of projects.
Yeah.
And it goes all the way down to the bottom, you see unreleased minutes, and it's segregated by year.
So one of the things that I asked Michael in one of the discussions we had Wednesday morning was our minutes end up in our packets. We approve them in the packets. But if we want to go back and find minutes more readily, it would be better if after they're approved at a minimum, they get put into a separate folder by year. That way, you got them all in one place. You don't have to go back to the. You might want to still go back to the minutes because of what went on a particular meeting. But keep in mind that the minutes and the meeting agenda are two different things because we're approving them on a later meeting. Mm. And so I thought it'd be a good idea to have them all in one place so we can look at them rather than have to go through tons of meeting agendas to find them.
Did you release anything prior to the? Have you ever released any executive session minutes
no,
yet?
No, we haven't released any since I've been on the board. That I did cross by. Steve,
it's been a while.
Steve goes back further.
It's been a while.
Mr. Chairman, through you, my understanding is that the board did release minutes up until approximately 1998, and
that's what
kind of caught this year as the starting point. And we also received a records request for a particular period of time, 2010 to 2016, if I remember as well.
So those have been reviewed.
That's right.
So I guess beyond getting this job done and going forward, we need to pay a little more attention to, at least on an annual basis, tackle the executive session and see what we want to. So I guess, you know, sometimes 2 or 3 years later, it's easier to release than the more current ones. Further discussion regarding this? Jeff?
No.
Oh, okay. So the ambulance abatement we have?
Mr. Chairman, I'd ask that because of the sensitivity, we just read the motion, which refers to a particular claim number.
Mr. Chairman, I move to abate ambulance charges in the amount of $613.26 for run number 28070 or 28070 on February 14th, 2016.
Second. Second by Mr. Steele. I gather this is a hardship case.
It is, and it was complied with our the board's policy requirements for abatement, which is why it was brought forward.
Okay.
We have had a number of inquiries requesting consideration, but none of those inquiries have met the statutory requirements for income levels. They've exceeded those levels and therefore not qualified for abatement.
Okay. On the motion, and further discussion? On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Unanimous? Town administrator's report.
Mr. Chairman, I did not submit a written report to the board for today's meeting. I'll be very brief with my verbal report. The first is, and I'm sure other board members will reference it, we do have the tree lighting on the common coming up a week from yesterday, this Sunday, and I just want to, in addition to thanking the North Reading Chamber of Commerce for their assistance with procuring additional lights, I just want to recognize the Department of Public Works, Andrew, and in particular Chris Stemming, the interim general foreman, for their hard work in getting the lights hung up there. You can see them as you're coming down Haverhill Street, and they look really good on that left-hand side. And again, that was done cooperatively with the chamber and with the Historic District Commission as well. And I think that the community will really benefit from that. And I just want to thank the Department of Public Works for their effort. I think that we'll all see a wonderful improvement to an already wonderful atmosphere there. I believe that concludes my comments. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. O'Leary?
Two or three things. First of all, yesterday we were all able to enjoy the annual Thanksgiving dinner. It was sponsored by Representative Jones and Senator Tarr, along with other sponsors such as yourself and your wife, Mr. Chairman. And again, another great community event. And again, I want to again publicly thank Representative Jones and Senator Tarr and everybody else for recognizing the absence of my mother for the first time since inception. And it was a nice tribute and greatly appreciated, and I'm sure she was looking down and enjoying every bit of it. She never minded being the center of attention, so. But it was a terrific event, and again, a wonderful thing, an event that's continued on and hopefully continues for many years to come. Secondly, I want to wish the North Reading Hornets well in their fight for Turkleys, the annual matchup with the Pioneers from Linfield this Thursday. I wish them well. They've had a terrific season. And
is the game here or in
the game Linfield? Is in Linfield.
In Linfield.
It's away, yeah. And then finally, just for those residents who are traveling, you know, just safe travel over the holiday. That's all, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Yes, I'll echo your sentiments on the Thanksgiving dinner. It always touches me when I sit at dais, able to do that, and to look at the faces of everyone there, the seniors, and those who help with taking care of the seniors. It's always very touching, especially when what is the entertainer's name? Do you recall?
Sergeant Clark.
Sergeant Dan Clark.
Sergeant Dan Clark does his salute to the armed services. I mean, you can see the pride in all their faces, and it's a very touching event. It may be one of the most important, if not the most important event that we have for the seniors throughout the year. So it was a wonderful dinner. The food was good, and the company was great. Also, this past Saturday, I spent some time with the Garden Club, and they do a lot of nice stuff around the town, making it a beautiful place. On Arbor Day, they plant trees. This past week, they had a bench of stone, it's between the gazebo and the entrance to the main park at IRP. But it's a little walk around there. Really nice. They've really done a nice job there. And you know, people don't realize what the Garden Club really does, you know. And sometimes you think of an intersection and they gussied that up or something like that. So I just want to give a shout out to them, thanking them for all that they do to make the, North Reading a more beautiful town than it already is. So, thank you. And happy Thanksgiving to everybody. How could I forget that?
All right. Catherine.
I just wanted to congratulate Sue Magner and the, you know, the veterans, the, on the Veterans Day ceremony. That was nicely done. It was moving. Nice job by Selectmen Yule as well. It was a very, very moving ceremony, and especially commemorating the Vietnam veterans. It was
for the first time that I can recall in all the 11 dates I've spent up on the hill, it was a nice day.
It was pretty windy.
It was windy.
The flag was hard to hear over the flag, but it was kind of appropriate that the flag was.
You just had to hang on to your speech.
Yeah. But very very nicely, nicely done. And same thing, just congratulate Mary Prenny and the Elder Services staff. That was a nice banquet, thanks to the sponsors and Representative Jones and his wife and Senator Tarr and Selectman Mosseri and your wife for sponsoring it. It really is an enjoyable thing, and you see everyone, they're all singing along with Sergeant Clark and just having a nice.
But don't forget the senior echoes.
And the senior echoes, yes. So, and then just hoping everyone has a peaceful, happy, enjoyable Thanksgiving.
Michael.
Yeah, I have three things. First one, I just want to remind everybody in town that our town bylaw states that any political sign needs to be removed 7 days after an election. Bob, I don't know if you can post this, but I think it's important that we get the message out, because the community probably doesn't know it, but it's time to take them down. It's time to move on. And I'm not trying to make a political statement by making this. It's the law by law, and I would just think the community needs to be educated that this law exists, the bylaw exists, and that we should do our best to abide by it. The water ban. Can we take action to exit the water ban and to remove those signs off the telephone poles and everywhere else around town? Or is it something that we have to keep in place?
Through you, Mr. Chairman, I certainly can review that with the Department of Public Works. I know the most recent advisory we got indicated that there still is certainly a drought situation ongoing. We can review that and have a recommendation for the next board meeting.
And the only reason I bring it up is that you drive through some of the neighborhoods, you see our big yellow signs, and the winter is coming, and the snow and the plows, some of the poles are pretty close, and I just don't want to see those signs get trashed because they're... We're going to probably need them.
Yeah.
So I figured let's catch them before the snow comes.
Removing the signs, I think we could certainly easily.
Okay.
The matter of the restriction is a different issue,
Okay. I thought you had to remove the ban to take down the signs, but that's fine.
I'll talk with the Public Works Director. I think it's a valid concern, especially once we get the first snowfall.
Yep. And I just want to let the community know that because it wasn't publicized or wasn't televised, that we did have a strategic planning session a few weeks ago. And that we, at some point, I assume, will finalize the strategic plan and vote to approve it. I don't know if that's in our schedule anytime soon.
I believe that the board left it, that there was a desire to review the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, right, and threats further, which we'll need to schedule at some point.
Throwing it out there, because...
Maybe Christmas Eve sound good?
I am going to the Patriots game, unfortunately.
Right after.
Is that Christmas Eve?
That's game, by the way, Michael, that's one of the reasons I talked to Michael Gilberto about taking some of these big core items and put them in and stretch them out over the next couple of months.
Okay.
Just before we get into the real heat of the budget process.
Yep. Just want the community to know, though, that we still, we take that plan seriously and that we are working on it. And again, happy Thanksgiving to everybody.
Thank you. Regarding Veterans Day, it's already been said it was a great event. We have to thank Susan for all of her efforts in getting that organized, and everyone else that obviously lended a hand to make it a successful event. Thanksgiving dinner, again, was great. And we mentioned Brad's wife, Lisa, who some of his staff put a lot of energy into all the details of making the day successful, the dinner successful. and it gets dark quite early, and I just suggest that we caution all our citizens to take heed driving around. We still have kids out in the dark, and especially the next couple of months as we're in the winter doldrums, to be very careful. And I want to wish everybody in the community a very happy and safe Thanksgiving, and to all my board members the same thing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Move to adjourn.
We have enough guts to go into an executive session to finish up or not?
I don't know that there's anything that's kind of urgently left.
The minutes, we'll do it on another.
The minutes, just as you're looking through the minutes to be released, to the town administrator's point, the rationale for the redacted portions, again, were, you know, negotiation strategy, you know, as far as the actions that the board took, those are being released. You know, personnel matters, litigation, pending litigation, litigation that has been settled, situations such as that is what hasn't been suggested redacted. The rest of it should be okay. Mm-hmm.
No, I was referring to the...
Oh, the other ones.
The other ones.
Oh, I mean, I have... Right.
I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So no executive session. No executive
motion
session.
Motion to adjourn.
Right?
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Second.
You want to hang around?
All in favor.
Aye.
Yeah.
Aye.
Aye.